Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Love Fruit Podcast. This is Ronnie, and I'm here again with Dr. Doug Graham, who has been a part of our podcast before, of course, and has one of probably our most popular interviews and has supported the podcast in the past and also the UK Fruit Fest for many years, Fruity Fridays, and other things that we're doing. Doug Graham is the author of the 8-10-10 Diet. 8-10-10 Diet book is an essential book, an essential reading for people who are interested in the raw vegan diet, but in general for people who want to understand human diet, human health, and a principle that can technically be added to any diet, really, could be incorporated in any style of eating to help with improving your health. Although probably most famously related to the raw vegan diet, I would suggest, and I do believe that what we see now a lot in the with people sharing information with raw food now, a lot of people are eating a fruit-based type of a diet, regardless of how they do that. Fruit-based type of a diet with mono meals with large quantities of fruit that's generally low fat. And whether they reference Doug or not, I think that Doug has played an enormous part in facilitating that message getting out there, in clarifying the idea, in figuring out how to do it in all sorts of situations, for all kind of people. So that's who Doug Graham is. If people don't know, he's a significant figure, and he is a well-regarded speaker, coach as well of the raw vegan diet. He was previously a chiropractor in his professional life and lived in Florida. Now he lives between actually England and wherever he is living, depending on where his retreats and various activities are. So this is Dr. Doug Graham. Doug, is there anything else you want to say about yourself?
Gosh, I'm honored by that, Ronnie. No, just that I really support you in any way I can. I think that you're just really sharp and tell the truth, and or at least as you see it, you tell the truth. I respect the insights. I've told you before, I respect your insights, and I'm just thrilled to be here.
There's a number of different ways that we could go in this conversation. We've had an interview before where I think we talked more about your background and story and things, and maybe we won't go into that as much this time around, but there's many places we could go with it. And I think that I'm essentially a student of yours, and I don't know officially or whatever, but I definitely see you as a mentor, see you as the person that laid particular path that I tried to look at and follow and appreciate and all that kind of stuff. And I've developed a way of thinking, I think, and looking at the raw food diet and health and nutrition. So I encounter all kinds of ideas out there, and that I think that's a problem a lot of people are having. They get a lot of ideas when it comes to health and nutrition, a tremendous amount of ideas. And I think one of the valuable things that I got from you is a framework of how to kind of look at that information and kind of break it down and understand it and see if it had any value or not. And generally, I realize a lot of these things don't have much value, so it doesn't bother me, all the weird, wonderful ideas. So I wonder, like, how did you develop maybe your way of thinking about this, of figuring out your philosophy on health, nutrition, and the way you look at things?
My dad was a very logical man, and he became more emotionally based as he got older, I noticed, but certainly as a young man, very, very logic. He was like Spock, you know, and I wanted to emulate that. I wanted to be like my dad. As a kid, And I found that my willingness to think things through and say, this doesn't make sense or this does make sense, somehow seemed to be at least at times stronger than others. Maybe it was my lack of filter. I don't know. And that I would point things out, point out wrongs where I saw them. But in the health field, I didn't really go there first. Where I went first was, what's the right thing? Can I recognize what's right? And what's right? What's true? What makes sense? What is nature showing us by the model in nature? What is history showing us by the teachings that we hopefully can pick up from studying through history and how things changed? And but then I met T.C. Fry, and T.C. Fry's influence was one that said, if you're not sure, just follow it through to the logical conclusion. Where does this thought take you? Is it a, I hear a lot of things from people. We need to eat more protein. 80, 10, 10 is good in the short run, but in the long run, your health will fail. All sorts of things people have told me over the years. And I go, well, let's just follow it through. Let's see. Well, if it's good for me in the short run, why would that make it bad for me in the long run? How is it bad? And I could go back and say, okay, how is it bad in the long run? And they'll say, well, it doesn't give you this or that, or it does give you this or that, or something gets out of balance. And that led me to years and years and years, a good part of 20 years of research about the raw food diet before I ever wrote anything, or it was 10 years before I even told anybody anything, but it was another decade before I really started writing things down and saying, I think I understand this well enough that I'm willing to put it in print. Because, and again, my own personal philosophy was that I work more like an artist. When you write a song, you and it's done, it's done. You don't rewrite the song, you write another song. When you paint a painting, when you decide it's done, it's done. And you don't go back 10 years later and say, actually, I didn't want it to look like that. Let me repaint it. I'm going to change that painting. You just paint a new painting. So I felt that way about the things I've authored.
That
I
makes sense. That
wrote
makes a lot
Grain
of sense.
Damage, 80, 10, 10, Nutrition, Athletic Performance, Prevention and Care, Perpetual Health. These things are now finished products.
Sure.
I'm not going back to change them. I may, in a future edition, put out a few new chapters to 80, 10, 10 because people are aware now about other areas. There's things that weren't relevant back then, like how do you raise a raw child? Well, it wasn't an issue back then. So I may add a, people have really lost the plot on diabetes, and whereas I only have a few pages about diabetes, it could be a whole chapter. So things like that I might add in. But even that, I'm not super motivated. I think the book stands fine on its own. And it was just a matter of, my father had a famous saying, or one that he used with me a lot, which was, put your brain on, switch your brain on before you put your mouth in
Yeah,
gear.
right. I've heard that.
I'm sure a lot of parents said that to a lot of kids. So as an adult, I still need to work on that because sometimes I am very reactive. I get emotionally quickly and get spontaneous. But professionally, I was trained in school to think things through and make sure you know what you're doing and get enough details. And I find when you have enough of the facts and information that the answer almost becomes obvious. It just jumps right out at you. Well, it's got to be this. So the model in nature was all the creatures built like us eat whole, fresh, ripe, raw, organic plants, mostly fruit, that all the creatures on the entire planet eat raw food,
That's,
that everything about our design is plant oriented. And I just got to a point where I said, I've got to live according with my beliefs. I really have to live in accordance with my beliefs.
yeah, amazing. And there's so many things to go on from there. But something that you said there that was a real insight for me is you said you saw it like writing that book or the things you've written as like an artist. Well, I guess a writer is an artist, but because the businessman would have 10 versions of 8 to 10, whatever it is by now.
Well, sure.
Right, or a different version every year, or 8 to 10 for this, 8 to 10 for that. So that's a real insight into the way your mind works, actually. The idea of having that complete picture and just having that perfectly crafted, it's quite interesting. You commented on TC Fry. And I think some people, or probably many people, think that. I think there may be people that think, "Oh, Doug got everything from TC Fry," and I don't necessarily think that's right, but
No, not at all.
maybe some people think that. But who was
No,
the big?
T.C. Fry was a tremendously influential man.
I'd like to.
He
But here's the question I would ask you: is who was he, and who was it to you? But also, in your opinion, what were his mistakes? I think that might be interesting to see.
Yeah, well, I can do that. There's a book written about T.C. Fry. Virginia Vetrano wrote a book about T.C. Fry and the mistakes that he made. So I won't go back over that, but and I don't agree with all the mistakes that she necessarily pointed out. But T.C. Fry was a man from Texas who grew up in a very simple way. By third grade, he dropped out of school. So he became self-educated. He's very interested in education, but not in school. And at 45 years old, he'd been living a pretty fast and furious life in the music industry, and was told to get his act together because he wasn't going to live much longer. And what we have in the States is a 4-day Thanksgiving weekend, and he decided to lock himself in his room and read a bunch of health books, which he did, and came out having had some profound realizations. He wanted to tell other people about it. He lost a bunch of weight. He turned his health around. After the doctors told him he wasn't going to live, he lived another 25 years, which is pretty darn good. He made some mistakes in that he often went to extremes where nature really didn't set that model for us. So he would try eating only one thing for extremely long periods of time, maybe live on watermelon or live on something, and not include a lot of greens. He went long periods of time without including any kind of vegetable matter at all, sticking only to what we would call culinary fruits, not even the botanical fruits. And he worked himself, well, I think he worked himself too hard, but he worked himself as motivated as he was. But he stayed at my house often, and he would get on the computer in the afternoon and not come off, and when I'd come down in the morning, he was still right where I'd left him, and he's still typing. And
Wow.
but my dad did the exact same thing. Just, really motivated to solve the problem. And it's a great time to work through the night because you don't get interrupted. But he did work a lot, and as I say, he was profoundly motivated. He started loads and loads and loads of seminars around the country, and had me come out. It was my, not my introduction to public speaking, but it was a place where I really got to hone my skills, because I did, we would do a weekend seminar in city after city after city in the United States. It would usually be he himself, TC, myself, and then a local host as a third presenter, wherever we went. And it was wonderful. But
Anyway.
as I started to say, he's super influential man. This is a man who he was the mentor for the people who sold the most popular health book ever written, Harvey and Marilyn Diamond. No book had ever sold a million copies before in the health field, and they sold 140 million or something like that. So it was quite a mind-blowing experience. And he was their teacher, and they quoted him often and credited him often. He was also a teacher for a man who's one of the most influential men alive right now, at least in terms of personal development field. You may have heard of Tony Robbins. TC Fry was Tony Robbins' mentor as well, and got him started. So critical thinking skills, very profound health awareness. I mean, that's who he was to me. And I'm glad that when he was in his 60s, I got to spend time with him, in cities all over the US. And as I say, he'd come to my house as well.
And what was happening at those? I mean, did he have a newsletter, or what did he have as a?
Yeah, he put out flyers. He used the US mail a lot. I mean, everything he did came through US mail. It was pretty late in his life before computers and reaching out on message boards even became possible. But he used US mail, and he had built himself quite a mailing list. And he sent out constantly. He was immensely prolific. I mean, he just never lost his desire to put out new material and put out new and create schools and create programs and retreats and centers. And he failed a lot of times. And he was quite willing to do that. He did. He failed a lot of times.
That sounds very entrepreneurial.
Yeah, he was.
That's kind of like,
He was willing to fail, and it left some people. He was also willing to fail with other people's money, which,
also sounds entrepreneurial.
yes, but it got a lot of people upset. And so there's a lot of people who will say, "Oh, TC Fry, he did this, but he used the money for other things." I don't know that that was true. I don't know any of that stuff. I didn't know him in his wild or wayward days. By the time I met him, he was almost a preacher. He was very sincere. He led a quiet life. He took great care of himself and just did the very best he could. He didn't complain when he suffered.
Did he get
He was
shot or something?
incredibly gracious man.
Did he get shot?
He got shot in the back of the head, point blank range, having an argument with a wife, and the wife shot him point blank in the back of the head, I think with a gun called a 22, which isn't a super powerful gun, not like a 45 or something, but enough so that you can kill people. with a 22,
Yeah.
but he just got fortunate. And there's, if you put your hand behind your head, you'll find there's a little bump back there just above your neck.
Yeah.
And that's a really super thick spot in your
Right.
skull.
Yep.
It's the spot you would typically hit if you fell backwards.
Ah.
Right. So it's designed to be the thick spot on the
Ah.
skull in case you fell over backwards.
Didn't know that.
And he got shot right there. And I mean, the bullet went into the bone, but that's as far as it got.
Wow. God.
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, fascinating stuff. And I guess it goes back to a bit of a conversation we had recently where getting back to some of the festival stuff, because you're coming to UK Fruit Fest once again. You've been the last 10 years every
I'm
year
so
at the
excited
event.
to come to UK Fruit Fest. I was talking about it with a friend today, explaining that it's the atmosphere is as close to electric as you can get. It's not ho
Fun.
hum, here I am at another festival. It's spectacular vibe, if I can use that. You know, like everybody knows they're at something very, very special.
Vibe is important, you know, it's an important thing to figure out, getting the right vibe. But and I've always thought these events have great vibes, great energies regardless. So I think fruit brings good people together and raw foods. And but an interesting thing we're talking about is, and I've said this to you, I've said this to other people, I don't think to some degree you get the credit, or people credit you as much as they could, or don't mention your name as much as they mention others. And when people say things like, I don't know, medical medium or Robert Morse or some or all these different guys that people might reference, I think, but no one's doing fruit-based diet without 80-10-10 having been written. Like that's really a trigger point for a lot of people on getting a good understanding of how can a fruit-based diet even work? How does it work? You know, how can people be at their healthiest with it and thrive on it? And all these questions answered. And the other thing that I was going to say that you gave to me was your message has always been when I watch you speech. Watch you talk and I watch you ask, answer a lot of questions. Is the message was always really, and you've said this a number of times, come on in, the water's fine, right? So at the raw food swimming pool, you're the guy that's saying, come on in, the water's fine. And I kind of feel like the raw food swimming pool is a whole bunch of people saying, the water's great, but really dangerous if you do this wrong. Or the water's great, but you really need to make sure you've got these equipments with you or else you're drowned. And you're the one guy, or you were the one guy saying, or one of the few people saying, the water's fine, like you're not gonna come
The
to
water's
any
fine. As far as I can tell, the water's fine. I don't look out for stuff. I don't take special precautions. I'm not, as you know, I'm not a fan of prophylactic anything. Certainly not prophylactic nutrition, prophylactic supplementation. So I don't eat this in order to get that, and I don't supplement with this in order to prevent that. I mean, none of that. I don't think nature's model is that screwed up that I can take something out of a bottle that's going to be better than what nature already gave me. If I want vitamin D, I can go outside in the sun and get all I want. If I need.
Yeah.
My health isn't failing. My mind isn't failing. My fitness isn't failing. I have no reason to suspect that something is wrong, or that it would be better if I supplemented with this, that, or the next. I'm not seeing that
Yeah.
as a common thread in 80, 10, 10.
And
But I also understand that if those people didn't do those things, they really wouldn't have anything to market at all.
well, that's where we're
And
getting.
I'm not saying that as a negative about them, but you know, what would they market? What would they say? Oh, just go buy 80-10-10 and do what Doug Graham says. I mean, that doesn't make them. And I'm, it's not an, honestly not my ego. I want the raw food to move, to grow up. I want the whole raw food program to grow. I mean, I've trained hundreds of presenters and more than 100 chefs. I want the movement to grow up.
Yeah, I don't know how you feel, but I've always, since I sort of started coming to events, I loved the raw food community, like the people, the tribe, the vibe. I've always just,
A lot of switched on people.
yeah, I think it's a really cool kind of community to be in. And my wishing desire is for that to grow and proliferate with a great message. And I do feel there's too many people at the door of the party or at the door of the swimming pool who are kind of saying, don't come in until you've got this, or don't, you got to worry about this. And I tried that. I know you're going to try that, but I tried that. And let me tell you what went wrong. And we were talking about the idea that in the past, at some of the raw food festivals and gatherings, that what you saw, because if I kind of open the doors, like who's the speaker that wants to speak at the festival? Who's got something relevant to our audience? Anyone can get on stage. Or even if I said you can pay and you'll get on stage or whatever, we would have, I was saying, we would have people talking about urine therapy, we'd have people talking about dry fasting, breatharianism, who knows what other, living on energies, living on sunlight, who knows? You'd have all the supplement people with all their various supplement ideas, people with very extreme ideas about healing cancer with this magical thing or that magical
Well,
thing.
we would just have the intuitives.
Yeah, and to some degree, the audience would be fascinated by all this, and maybe
Yes.
there's an entertainment value to it all, or a variety. Some people say I want more variety, but I mean, I don't really. I personally think a lot of that information is dangerous. Whenever it comes to health information, I'm just thinking worst case scenario, and I'm thinking this is dangerous stuff. So, tell me about some of the raw food events of the past, because really the ones I've been to have been 80, 10, 10 mostly, and I don't like it when I hear someone talk about supplements, which occasionally happens. But maybe you've seen all sorts of other things at raw food events from the past. Maybe you could share some stories.
Well, I didn't go to the very first ever San Francisco Raw event. I missed that one. Don't know how, but I did go subsequently, even to the San Francisco Raw events. They happened back in the 90s. And back then, many of the people who are still involved in the raw movement or in the health movement are still around. And it was interesting meeting them. They Do you know the book Blink? Have you read the book Blink? Malcolm
Malcolm
Gladwell?
Gladwell. Yeah.
Yeah. Great book. I thought great book. And just like the premise in the book, you knew instantly it was going to be a great book. Which is the premise to the book, is that you know instantly.
Right.
And because I was meeting so many new people whom I'd already heard of or read their stuff, it was fascinating experience going to that San Francisco Raw, meeting these people and almost instantly being able to size them up. Because I already knew what I was into. I already had 20 years of hygiene behind me, and I was really clear. Health comes from healthful living. We're designed as raw foodists, on through the basic premises. And fruit is our natural food. And then I'm hearing people explain to me that if you take oats and soak them for 3 days, changing the water once each day, they'll start to germinate and soften, and then the carbohydrates will start to break down. And if you then drain off all the water and add some raisins, it'll be almost like you were eating oatmeal. It'll be almost that oatmeal will be almost as sweet as if you were eating fruit because you've given it 3 days in water to sort of break down. And I'm thinking, when I want to have something sweet, I don't generally feel like I want to wait 3 days just to get my hands on something sweet. But had an eye-opening experience. I was in Portland at a raw food festival that ran in Portland for 5 years, every summer for 5 years. It was the biggest gathering that really ever happened in raw foods. It was happening at Portland at the time. And my goodness, there's 50 presenters, and it's a 4-day festival, and everybody gets a shot at the stage. And a weird thing happened, right? There's maybe 25 or 30 vendors, each of which is going to be a speaker. And when they go up on stage, they're pretty true to form, explaining why their line of supplementation was the right one for everybody. Why theirs was special, different, unique, why the testing methods weren't valid, and so they had to use their supplement because it was stronger or whatever or better. And everybody had this marketing thing of selling their stuff. And then because it's a traveling road show, essentially the roadie on the show was UPS. So the parcel service had to deliver everybody their supplements. And they didn't show up on the day that they were expected. They didn't show up till the next morning. So I just by chance, because I was teaching a fitness class, I was there when the supplement delivery came. And the guy came with maybe, I don't know, 100, 200 boxes of supplements.
Wow.
Easily 200 boxes of bottles of supplements, right? And distribute that between 20 or 30 different vendors. Some had four and some had 10 and whatever much they thought they could sell at the event. And the guys and gals started, hang on. The guys and gals started unpacking their boxes, and it was all the same bottles. It was all the same stuff, no labels at all. And then they got busy putting their own labels onto the same product. Everybody had the exact same product, just different labels.
Which
I've
is
seen that since.
basically, I mean, that every supplement salesman, and I think that there's a lot of people. Think a lot of people have ideas about nutrition that are marketing concepts from supplement companies, and a lot of people don't seem to know that and don't seem to have wised up to that. Like this was created by marketers. This is not real information, right? So, but they all want to give an appeal, which is. No, my stuff, we come from like the really good farms, and the really we've got a scientific lab and people
We've got the
working
best
24
soil.
hours, and our formula, we've really been just making the for like we've been testing the formula, we've been taking all the most recent research, and it's like it's all the same stuff from the same factories,
I was shocked. It was all the same stuff. I had no idea. I eventually visited a friend of mine in California who worked for a company called Bolt House. They make carrots. They don't make carrots, but they sell, process and grow and process and sell carrots. And turns out that 75% of the carrots grown in the United States go through the Bolt House factory. It's a lot of carrots, 300 million people's worth of carrots, in the end, I'm watching carrots getting bagged up to go to grocery stores. And it's one machine with six different funnels, and the carrots fall into the bags. And they were six different bags. There's like Happy Bunny brand that sells cheap and cheerful, and there was some elite brand. It was all the same carrots. So this whole idea of it's all the same supplements is not a new one. It's a standard marketing tool. But I have to tell you, I'm a pretty innocent guy in a lot of ways. I was like, wow, you guys all have the same stuff, and then you just put your own labels on it. So it just reinforced my feeling that I'm never selling supplements. I'm never selling any kind of repeat products.
I'm curious,
Education is my deal.
did anyone ever come to you and say, like, well, this is what we have to do, this is what works, this is what people want to buy? Did anyone ever put it to you like that, or
Sure.
did they really believe in it, like it was essential for people to have supplements?
Behind closed doors, which would often happen, because we would do events where the host or the hostess would house us all. So there'd be myself and maybe five or six other presenters, and we all just crash at the host's house in Pennsylvania or in Atlanta, Georgia, or in Texas, or it didn't matter where it was, right? And so behind closed doors, you'd get to have dinner with just the speakers, just the presenters, just the heavy hitters, whoever it was, right? And it often came out that they had a very low regard for their audience, that they really were in it just because they could sell something, and they had found a market of people who were, to use the phrase of marketing specialists, they had found people who were fans. Okay, now, as you know, in European football, fans get a little over the top sometimes. They don't just go to watch the game. They go to make a point. They go to beat up the other fans of the other team. They go to be rowdy. They definitely want to be noticed, and fans are actually, it's a shortened version of the word, right? It's really fanatics. The word is fanatics. It just got shortened to fans. And whether you're a fanatic about cats, or a fanatic about golf, or a fanatic about raw food, once you're fanatical, not only do you become more vulnerable, but you're very, very easy to separate you from your money. Tell somebody, hey, we've got the best golf club in the world, and it's so much better than all the other golf clubs, or our golf ball is better than all the other golf balls, or whatever it is. And all the golfers will buy it because, I mean, they'd be stupid not to. And the same exact thing, the raw food movement drew its own fair share of people who only got into it because they were marketers. And there was an audience. Give me an audience, every educator wants an audience, and as does every marketer want an audience.
And the way I've sort of seen it is, with what I've seen in the modern days, is that it was easier for people to find sort of attention or prominence or whatever within the raw food movement, or get to be a speaker or be prominent in some way or gain a following, than if they tried to be that, say, in the vegan movement generally, or just generally in the hit, like just at any health event. It was easier for them to gain some kind of a notoriety within this smaller group.
Exactly, notoriety to gain a foothold,
Get a
to
foothold
gain
to
a
then,
following.
yeah.
Yeah, we're not here to name names, but I can think of people still to this day who, you know, I used to do a talk about who's vulnerable and who's vulnerable to the marketers, who's vulnerable to be taken advantage of. And, you know, sick people are certainly very vulnerable, and as are health seekers, very vulnerable. The uninformed, the wealthy, and the people striving to be their very, very best. These people are
Interesting.
all quite vulnerable,
Interesting.
you know.
Yeah.
So you get different ends of the spectrum, even, and they're vulnerable. If somebody's very sick and you get told, well, you know, if we just take this green goo and we shove it up your butt and you hold it in there for a while, and think the right thoughts or listen to the right music or the right color light. And I'm not knocking any of those things. I just think nature is set up in a way that allows us to be our best. We naturally are, you'll like this, we're naturally nurtured by nature.
That's a great phrase. Is that
Maybe.
the
Yeah. We are naturally nurtured by nature. She gives us grassy fields, and we can lay down and look at the view and feel the breeze and feel the warmth of the sunshine and
new
take a sip of cool water, cool fresh water, and bite into some juicy fruit, sweet, juicy fruit, you know, just scrumptious,
book?
and sit there and just share a view with somebody, of how gorgeous it is, and watch the leaves change color or whatever it is. It's dark a lot. It's dark a lot. I know that now it's the height of summer. It's hard to say that even, but it's dark a lot. And it's really easy to sleep when it's dark. You know, in our natural environment, it's dark 12 hours a day. We would naturally, if we were truly like we didn't even have a candle, we would go to bed as soon as it got dark, and we wouldn't get up until it got light, because there'd be no point and no effort to do so, and you'd be spending 10, 11, 12 hours a day in bed as a normal natural part of your, absolutely put in a full day the rest of the time. I remember being in Costa Rica one time, and I ran past this guy who was sitting on a rock looking at a creek that was pretty in the woods. I was on my way to the beach, and when I finished at the beach, I ran back past him, and he was still there sitting at the rock. And I didn't know if he was waiting for a bus or what he was doing. And I said, you know, what are you doing? He goes, I'm just sitting. I go, it is a really beautiful spot. And he goes, yeah, I just come here occasionally and just sit for a while.
Wow.
He'd been there for the almost easy 3 hours, just sat. That was what, you know, and sitting is a ends in ing, therefore it's a verb. What was he doing? He was sitting, you know. And they say we're a lot like orangutan. You know, the orangutans are considered the philosophers of the jungle. They spend a lot of time just sitting around doing nothing, because there's nothing to do. It's not like we have to do. I love to be, I love personally in my life, I love to be of service. I love to be helpful, valuable, useful, productive. I love all that stuff. It gives me a great feeling to provide a service, a benefit to other people. To me, that's a mission for me, to help people grow and change and become better. I love when people tell me they can't do something and then I teach them how, and then they can. It just is very fulfilling for me. But we all have our things that are very fulfilling. And here we are on this beautiful planet. If you started at least one UK Fruit Fest saying, we don't think health is that important until we don't have it. And then it's the only thing we think about. It's the only thing we pursue. When you don't have your health, it becomes the most important thing in life. When you do have it, you just sort of take it for granted and don't think much about it and just get on with things. When you don't have it, the only thing you get on with is trying to get your health back. So I'm super, I count myself as fortunate. I've spent a long time healthy and continue and expect to continue doing so, but which means that I could be productive and I could pursue all the things that were interesting to me, whatever they were. And I love that I could pursue that. Whereas if I'd been sick, the only thing I'd be pursuing is trying to find an answer to my sickness.
So let's ask you a question then about an idea that's out there a lot of causing a lot of confusion with a lot of people in raw foods is this, and maybe I've asked you about this before, the microbiome. This is something that's coming up a lot with people, especially the idea that a problem people are having in that raw foods diet is they're not getting enough variety, and this is bad for the microbiome, and that's why people aren't thriving on a raw diet and stuff like that. Do you have any ideas, or do you have knowledge about the microbiome, what that is, how that works, how
Sure.
that is related to your health, how that
Sure.
impacts your health? Fire away.
I don't believe that there's any body hacks that we can perform that are better than what nature set us up with in the first place. I don't believe we can, I don't know if this is an English word. In America, it's an American word, maybe. But if you understand, I don't believe we can jimmy with our diet in order to try to change things, fix things. That's not how it works at all. To adjust our micro, oh, I'm going to eat this because it's good for my microbiome. Please. You have personal. I openly expressed your disdain, even, but certainly your disbelief on a lot of the things that are being touted as important in the raw food movement. And I think that's great. This is another one, as far as I'm concerned. I'm not eating for my microbiome, but I do like to have a happy tummy. I don't enjoy eating till I hurt, or getting a sour stomach, or as R.C. Deeney coined the phrase, perfect poo. I prefer to have perfect poo. It's a pleasure, right? Like, this is, there's a reason that they put the word relief on bathroom doors. Because it's not just a relief. It's very often one of the big pleasures in life, going to the bathroom, being able to. So
It should be a pleasure.
it's supposed to be,
Yeah.
all of the essential functions of life are pleasurable functions.
That's something I heard from you.
Yes.
And you also said there's an opposite side to that, where you said the body should never be uncomfortable or something like that, like
We're
the
not,
shouldn't cause
I don't
discomfort.
know if I said that exactly. I think of fitness training, occasionally we have to push ourselves through moments of intensity. And how you view that, right? Like some people view that as, oh, that's a hardship. That's a terrible
Right.
thing. I never want to stress or strain myself. And I'm going, no, it's to me, not only is it fun, I love the challenge, but I also know that this is how I stimulate growth. This is how I stimulate personal development. That there's no strength without stress. We're not trying to avoid stress. But we have to recover properly from the stresses to which we subject ourselves. The microbiome, though, I'm not trying to control my microbiome, whether that's on my skin or on the lens of my eyes. I mean, you have a microbiome everywhere, right? Like we're like moss-covered buildings as far as having microbes on us, in us, on us, inside of us, all around us. We're breathing it in. We're breathing in up 10 to 100,000 particles with every breath. Your microbiome changes with everything you eat. So if you eat romaine lettuce until you're just don't want any more, and then you switch over to bib lettuce, butter lettuce, or some other lettuce, little gem, your microbiome changes accordingly.
But the way I look at that is, I was thinking about this today. Like, if I leave fruit out in my kitchen and I just leave a bunch of fruit there, it starts to open up and rot, then my kitchen's going to be filled with fruit flies if there's fruit flies in the vicinity. If
There are.
and the temperature's right. If I leave some other food or some other substance, then maybe flies or ants or something else is going to develop. And but that's not a, that doesn't say anything about my kitchen or anything. Like, that's just there's something that's happening there, which is an obvious thing that happens. There's more food for those animals, so they develop. And that's I can't see the relevance of microbiome tests and all this stuff to some of the main challenges people have: weight loss, cardiovascular issues, blood sugar related issues, diabetes and stuff like that, cancer, autoimmune diseases, digestive conditions. I'm seeing those much more connected simply to diet as a big factor, and other health, other
There's
like
so many macro things to take care of
right.
before we need to start worrying about the micro things.
Right.
And I agree with you. So for me, I don't believe that it's harmful in any way to eat the same foods year round. You don't need to rotate your greens. I've seen no evidence that we need to rotate our greens or that we need to change our But nature provides us with variety throughout the year. Like whatever's in season now isn't going to be in season 4 or 6 weeks from now. And this nature provides an ongoing cycle of fruit availability that does allow us, it does foster some change in the microbiome. I know when I used to live in Florida, we'd only get mangoes June, July, and August. And every June, I'd struggle with mangoes for a week or so until I developed the appropriate microbes to deal with the mangoes because they're kind of special. And some people say, you know, when it gets to be cherry season, they struggle for the first couple of days of eating cherries. They have a profound effect, but then you get used to it and then it's not so profound anymore. And this is all microbiome, but I'm not going to eat things in order to, I don't understand microbiome well enough that I want to start choreographing millions and millions of different microbes that grow inside of me, as if I could choreograph that whole symphony. I can't. I know that there are, from school, you know, I learned that there are thousands, tens of thousands of colonies of microbes in our intestinal tract, each one performing a slightly different function. And they're in different It's like having different cities all throughout Europe. Each one is a little different and they do different things. And if I eat a lot of meat, then the colony of microbes that deals with meat will flourish and get, more profound. And if I don't eat any meat, then those microbes will eventually pretty much go away. And other microbes will take over. My microbes are really good with bananas and lettuce and the few other things that I subject them to on a regular basis. But I don't need to. Last of my worries about the microbiome.
But it's one of those things. Someone said to me today, what did they say? Bandwagon or something. Like once in a while a bandwagon comes along and a lot of people jump on it, and it goes somewhere for a period of time, and then they find something else to jump on. But anyway, I don't want to get too negative.
No, not at all. I think sometimes we have to remember whether we're the dog or the tail.
I love, as I say, I love the people that are making an effort to get good information out there and share the information. I just think there's a lot of people out there that I would be concerned about putting out the information they're putting out because of how dangerous it can be, how misinterpreted it can be. And that's just some thoughts I have. But I do think that education is important. Getting around the right people is important. And the festivals and the events have just been a joy. A lot of them have been, maybe not every single moment, but a lot of them have just been a joyful experience. And as you're saying, quite exciting for people and motivating. And I mean, I'm proud of the fact that if I sell someone a supplement, they might, I think it's funny the amount of people that buy supplements that probably never take them. They're sitting in a cupboard somewhere. But at least for the festival, I know that people got something out of it. They got something out of it. They got an experience. They got something for the money. So,
I think people
but
get a very blissful experience when they come to a festival. I think people who are relatively new to raw foods, who get to experience 4, 5, 6, in your case, 7 days of just eating raw, they already see the profound benefits of raw food long before the festival is really getting going. We just did this recently with a guy I know who's known about raw food for about 20 years, but he's never gotten himself to really go raw. He said 10 years ago he got on it for a little bit, got a few months, but nowadays, no, there's cooked food in every day, and there's times where there's not much raw food, and he wants to get back to it because experience has taught him that does better. Well, he came to a retreat. By the second day, he said, "My running's improving." And then the third day, he goes, "I needed less sleep." And then the fourth day, he's going, "I can tell I'm thinking more clearly. And my running's improving still." And then, and I've stayed in touch with him now for a few months since the festival. And he's going, "How did I ever get distracted? This is the best thing. I'm just getting improvements day after day after day. I'm running faster." This is a man that's almost 70 years old. And he goes, "I'm running faster than I have in more than 20 years.
yeah,
It
people
just,
can get.
and I haven't changed my training. I haven't changed my running. I haven't changed my job or my sleep or anything else. The only thing I did was I just changed from cooked vegan to raw vegan. And it's like 20 years came off my performance."
I really think people underestimate the difference. I mean, a lot of people want to talk about whole food, plant-based, whole food, beans and all that stuff and whatever starches and healthy, they'll say a healthy cooked food diet, and I'm when I hear the phrase healthy cooked food, I'm just like, That doesn't make sense to me, but that's healthier, I get less bad than other, but and I think people have not appreciated the difference. There's a big difference, don't you think? Sorry, I didn't finish the question properly there, but
No, I agree. I think people underestimate the power of raw food. I think they underestimate the value of a festival. A lot of people go, oh, what do I need to go to that for? I know my daughter was raised as a raw foodist, and she lives in a raw food home where there's no question of raw food. And still, she finds the reinforcement that comes from going to a festival essential in her life, not just important, not just a happy day. She's talking about the festivals all year long, can't wait to go to the next one. What other ones can she go to? Wouldn't miss. I'm telling you, she schedules her life around UK Fruit Fest. It's that important. There's no way she, I've watched her turn down opportunities to go to horse camp, and she loves horse. I watched her turn down opportunities to go to music camp, and she loves music. And she goes, no, nothing, nothing. I'm not going to miss UK Fruit Fest.
Amazing.
It's really important. And as you know, I've certainly never missed one. Because it's really important to me too. I love being there. I think in some ways, kind of like you love being there. It's actually just a great place to be. It's a great place to hang out. I remember when you were going to fruit festivals, just learning about them. And I'm going, why are you coming to all these festivals? He goes, well, I enjoy them. It's a good place to be.
You
It's
know,
fun. You were playing basketball by yourself and having a good time at a festival.
it's a great container, but like I feel like that's enough of a reason. Like for me in life, I've realized it's like if someone says to me, "Why do you do a raw food diet?" I'm happy to say I enjoy it. That's a big reason I do it is I really enjoy eating a raw food diet. I enjoy that. Why do I go to the festivals? Really enjoy them. I get joy out of them. I enjoy that, and I think that's a good thing to go towards, and that's a healthy thing to go towards. And there's a lot of people in life that are going towards things that they don't enjoy, or that they don't like, or that are bad for them, or they don't think they deserve. There's a lot of people have that sort of I've not worked hard enough to deserve to do or whatever. Which is fine, but I've realized that a lot in life. I don't need a bigger excuse to do something than this is something I enjoy. I mean, I still get something out of every class I attend. Any lecture, any if I'm listening to someone talking about this, I'll probably hear some perspective. I think more similar to what you said, I can probably size people up a lot more of like, okay, I can see where they're coming from. I know where they've got that information from. I can predict what they're going to say next. Like I kind of know the patterns.
I've said to you before, you are sitting in an audience while I'm giving a presentation, and I don't want to just say the same old thing. I don't want to be so predictable that you go, oh yeah, if you've already told all those stories, Doug. So I appreciate you saying, oh, that's a new phrase, right? Like maybe that's going to be the new shirt.
Well,
Nature.
because
Natural living nurtures,
that is
nurtured
a
by
great,
nature.
yeah, you should definitely do something with that, naturally nurtured. But I think that, yeah, people have said that to me, oh, Doug Graham, I've heard it all or whatever, I've heard Doug speak. And I think, I mean, yeah, there are stories you tell that you tell in a number of your speeches that are the same story. I get that. But,
Sure.
what I would say about yourself is people don't take the advantage of the question and answer sessions, the chance to speak to you more. And people should really prepare good questions. And I think that's a failure people have. They turn up at the event, they forget all their questions, all the things they think about at home. They just enjoy the event, they forget all the problems they have. When it comes to the question and answer, no one's got their hand up. And it's like, or if they do have their hands up, it's all the wrong questions. I think that you've always got something different to say. You've always got new information, or maybe not new
Well,
information,
for me,
but
no, there's definitely, I mean, I'm gonna, hopefully I'm gonna surprise you this year at the festival. I've got a couple of talks that I'm building right now that,
let me go through some of your talks. Yeah, I've got we've not fully finalized the schedule, which is a failure of mine every year, is not getting the schedule right. But I do kind of like you were
yeah.
saying, your book's like an art, and I guess the festival's like trying to put together a work of art, and I say, so we've got
Like herding cats. The festival's like herding cats.
Raw Foods Explained, raw myths. You're doing a speech on osteoporosis, which I've never seen you do before. Are you a candidate for osteoporosis?
Yeah.
Bigger versus better. And I think you've got one on raw food recipes, 101 raw recipes or something like that, or is that what it's called? 101 raw recipes, yeah. So a lot of variety in your speeches as usual. Do you have any particular theme or particular thing you're trying to get across this year, or anything that's important to you at the moment?
I want people to have more confidence
Sure.
that their bodies will do the right thing.
Right.
I think this is a forest for the trees kind of a problem because, you know, from the very first, well, even before sperm met egg, your body's been doing the right thing ever since. It turned into you. It grew into you, this person who could figure out how to play a guitar and sing a song at the same time. You cut yourself and you heal, you eat food and it digests, you go to sleep and you wake up with more energy, you have ideas, we do beautiful things and delightful things and coordinated things and we create complex things, we create ultra simple design that's beautiful to look at, listen to, whatever it might be, to smell or whatever else, please our senses. We found a lot of ways to please our senses and to think that we know better than our body, or we know better than the design of that applies to all living organisms. To think that we know better, I think this is a profound delusion. This is a profound delusion. If we just, mothers know when they have newborns that they need to nurture their babies. It doesn't matter. It could be lion cubs or, you know, baboons. It doesn't matter. We know we nurture our youngsters because they're so precious. Because we want them to develop. And somehow how that gets twisted into let's see how much we can abuse ourselves, to me is sad.
Oh, I saw a bad one the other day, which was, have you ever seen people that do the extreme body change? So,
Yeah.
you know, you got tattoos at the lower end and earrings and all that.
Piercings and cuttings and
Yeah, but oh
insertions and the
yeah,
bumps and the horns and
it goes far, but it's getting to the point now that people are like removing fingers to get a particular look, and it's
yeah.
I. That makes me squirm. I really don't like that.
Well, you know, people, it is within human nature for us to gawk, and and to love to gawk. Okay. And this is how fashion works. It's how a lot of entertainment works is we show you something that you've never seen before. that you wouldn't even have imagined had it not been, some of the music. You think of some of the musicians that go out on stage that were, dressed up as something people never seen before, designs and costumes, and I'm going, wait a minute, but I was just going for the music. I didn't realize there was a show. I thought it was just going to be music. And the hourglass figure, I mean, nobody had an hourglass figure before it became a fashion thing. People had functional figures. They were shaped like barrels because that's how you get work done. Barrels are strong. And the hourglass, the broad shoulder, narrow waist, this stuff is like, oh, bodybuilders in general, like we look at them, we stare at them. We love to gawk because we recognize natural beauty. Okay, we know that you might not know the name of the limp, but you can tell when somebody's limping. You might not know, oh, that's tertiary syphilis, or that's a drop foot, or that's a whatever. You might, you don't know, but you can tell when somebody's limping. You can tell when somebody's coordinating. When somebody swings a baseball bat perfectly, you can tell. When somebody hits a tennis ball well or poorly, you can tell. And, somebody goes running by and it's just perfect. And then somebody else goes running by and you go, oh man, that person shouldn't even be running. That's a repetitive use injury waiting to happen. And our eyes
Absolutely, yeah.
recognize that.
Right, yeah. I hear what you're saying, yeah.
Perfection is profound, and it's why we think so highly of the youth, right? Like they're still perfect. I want people to have more trust in the profound perfection that we call nature. It's been, I don't know how long it took to work it all out. I can't say whether it's billions of years or it was just last Thursday, but whatever it took to work it out, we're dealing with a system that cannot be improved upon. And the I think again, the people who are saying, oh, we're going to create human 2.0. Nope, this is a profound delusion.
It's yeah. Well, I've taken up a lot of your time today. Appreciate that, and now you've got other things to get on to. But
Oh, bless.
looking forward to seeing you at the festival. A great chance to chat to you again. Maybe we'll get
Wow, to just have
time for
conversations with people who aren't asking you, where do you get your whatever it might be? And instead, they're actually interested in you, or they're actually interested, want to tell you about their lives. This chance to get together with human individuals, real live time, get together with people and talk and as they say, sit shoulder to shoulder and make friends. I know so many friendships that started at the UK Fruit Festival.
yeah,
Please, please, I want to come back every year.
it's been a great great fun thing. It's been successful in many ways, and yeah, hopefully we'll have people support it again this year. We will have we're
When's it
aiming
going to be?
26th of July to the 2nd of August. We're aiming for 120 people. We still have some tickets left, so people can contact me. Info@fruitfest.co.uk is an email address, fruitfest.co.uk for the website. And just get in touch. We'll try and figure out a way of getting you there. We have people coming from all over Canada, Australia, America, all around Europe, Israel. So a bunch of people from all over the place. So anyway, Doug, thank you. We'll see you
Can
soon.
I
Finish off with whatever you like. Yep.
well, I'd like to ask one question that borders on blatant marketing, if it's okay.
Of course, yeah.
I'm interested because someone asked me, I'm interested if anybody be willing, not willing, if anybody would be interested in spending 10 days with me in November in Bali. If you're interested in spending 10 days with me in Bali in November, drop me an email. That's all.
Fantastic, thank you. I've never seen you out there. I've never seen you out in Southeast
First
Asia.
time.
Is
Well,
that
other than Australia and New Zealand,
no,
but
that
first.
need that needs I feel that needs to happen. I feel like Doug Graham has to visit Southeast Asia very
Yeah.
soon.
Bali in November, 10 days,
Awesome.
profound experience.
Awesome. Thank you, Doug. Thank you everyone for watching, for listening. Please share, and thank you for watching the Love Fruit Podcast. We'll see you in the next episode. Thank you.
Lovely talking with you, Ronnie.